Welcome to the Brain Coffee Podcast, where Drs. Eric Luthard and Albert Kim unlock life's little mysteries about health, wellness, entertainment, technology, and how the brain makes sense of it all. Sit back, relax, and open up your mind.
Hey, how are you?
Not bad.
Good. Once again, a good kolache.
Yeah, kolaches are quite good here. Hope we're allowed to say that.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, exactly. I think so.
But they are really good.
I know they are really good. Have you been keeping track of the news recently?
You're talking about the shootings and things like that.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know, I think what's interesting is even though kind of we see that quite literally on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah,
you know,
a few times a week.
When you see it in the news, it's still, you know, it affects schools. It still kind of affects you kind of emotionally on a deeper level. On a day-to-day basis, you know, when I'm on call, you know, somebody comes in who's shot in the head.
You know, right. I mean, just last week we had to deal with a young guy who was the recipient of, you know, I guess maybe a bad discussion or some argument or something like that. And yeah, it's pretty dramatic.
To me, it seems that, you know, whereas these events, you know, are absolutely emotionally devastating because they're affecting children, the fact that they happen every day in every city, you know, is really quite incredible.
Yeah.
You know, when we think about that relative to kind of, you know, diseases or anything else, it truly is an epidemic.
Yeah, it's a very frequent event. And actually, you know, I would probably argue that we don't hear about a lot of the times that we see it on
the
news.
That's right. It's the tip of the iceberg, right? Because the people who get shot and then don't make it to the hospital,
right?
There's a large percentage of them as well.
Exactly.
Because one of the questions I always ask myself is, it was interesting you brought up the whole kind of, you know, issue of, you know, was the recipient of a bad conversation.
Like, yeah.
Meaning, what goes on in somebody's head when they kind of, you know, pass some threshold where they decide to use, you know, kind of violent force against another human being?
So you're talking about like extremes of normal emotion, or are you talking about sociopaths?
That's a good question. So for instance, somebody has such a, you know, emotionally, you know, kind of violent reaction that they respond in force beyond what is, you know, reasonable, meaning that, you know, you get so angry you decide to shoot somebody.
Right.
You know, but even there, like, you know, where are your neural circuits breaking down to say, you know what, the fact that he, you know, cut me off in traffic doesn't warrant, you know.
Exactly. Where does
plugging somebody, right?
Does reasonable anger turn to a crime of passion, turn to kind of, you know, something more extreme?
Devastating
than that.
Violence.
Right.
And you're kind of really pointing to something very different, which perhaps is more involved in kind of, you know, organized crime, is when, you know, it's a very calculated, measured effort.
Right,
meaning,
right.
You know, again, this idea of, you know, somebody's behaving like a psychopath or a sociopath. And clearly there is a neuroscience behind that.
Right. Exactly. The emotions are quite different in that case. It's not these extremes of passion necessarily. They're actually
quite the suppression of it.
Exactly. You know? They're dampened.
Right. For instance, people have done functional imaging on people in prison, you know, who are kind of who rank high on psychopath, you know, assessments.
Right.
They have a number of, you know, areas of the brain that are notably different from a normal brain. Their amygdala, again, the seat of emotion is smaller. Mm. And so they're not processing their emotions as much. And the neural circuits that connect to the amygdala, these kind of basal frontal lobe areas, which are associated with emotional processing and inhibition, are reduced.
Right.
So basically, the thinking is that they have less ability to inhibit themselves. Mm-hmm. They have less emotions associated with their behavior, i.e. less remorse. If they want something or want to do something, they have less inhibitions about kind of the social norms.
Right, so they lack empathy, really.
That's exactly it.
And then couple that with they have no remorse, they can do things in a calculated way.
Part of that reduced inhibition is they don't think through the consequences as well. Kind of that's also frontal, right? You know, they don't see that, like, hey, look, you know, if I'm part of, you know, kind of this gang and decide to shoot somebody, that I may get caught.
Right.
And I may go to jail for this. Like, there's also kind of a reduced sense of consequences.
Right. Wonder if they can play chess.
Right, yeah,
maybe
right.
Not,
right.
Huh?
Maybe not, right. Right. They'll just constantly go for the quick kill, but in the long run, we'll lose the game.
Yeah, so that's interesting. So we have all this functional imaging. You know, it's been all over the news and scientific publication, things like that. I mean, I don't want to be fatalistic about it, but can you predict who's going to be this way before they get to prison?
People have talked about that. There's a couple interesting, I think, features to this. Is that one, just on a pure legal level, increasingly people are starting to use the legal argument, don't blame me, my brain did it.
Right.
You know, like, you know, I've got some abnormalities in my brain and that's responsible for this criminal action, invalidating my culpability, right?
Right,
you
right.
know, and that gets at this fatalistic idea. But also, I remember some, you know, kind of studies about this where basically they've done imaging on, you know, baseline brain activity, mm-hmm. and based on kind of their network behavior, it can predict lifetime success. For instance, if you had imaging of somebody, you know, early on in life, maybe as a child or even youth, that could you predict that they have, you know, predispositions towards psychopath or sociopath type of behaviors? Or on the other end of the spectrum, that this is a person really geared for success.
High-end executive,
yeah, exactly.
or something like that.
Right, right. Like,
that's interesting.
And which may, I mean, interestingly, may kind of start to separate out, you know, kind of nature versus nurture, right? And,
right, right.
I don't know, this is an old movie, I don't know if you remember it. Do you remember Gattaca?
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and that was a really,
yeah,
that was a great science fiction movie where basically everybody was assessed by their, you know, kind of their genome and their probability for success and where they should be in society based on their genome. As people started to fake their genomes, right? And
right.
It gets at this, don't blame me, my brain did it. Like, but you know, like how much does your brain's architecture determine kind of, you know, who you'll be and what you'll be?
Aside from certain well-known diseases where the one gene, it's mutated, you get the disease.
Right.
A lot of things are like 25 to 50% genetic,
right.
and then 50 to 75% environmental, you know?
That's right, that's right. You know, the environment affects your epigenome, you
right,
know, and that
right.
turns genes on and off. But I think similarly, like, I guess the reason not to be fatalistic about it is that the brain is an incredibly plastic organ,
right.
especially in youth, where basically you can train your brain up just as you can train your body up to do impressive things, or impressively bad things,
right,
you know?
Yeah, no, that's interesting. I mean, that argument comes up with video games, right?
Right.
And sociopathy.
Basically playing a lot of video games.
Violent, you know, point of view shooter games.
Right, right. It just kind of essentially kind of gears your brain up to do that type of behavior.
Exactly. It makes you numb to it and makes you more likely to do it. I mean, I played a lot of video games as a kid.
Right.
Not necessarily shooters, it's more like Space Invaders. But coming from that background, I kind of cringe whenever I hear that.
Mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
It's kind of along the same vein as saying, you know, Hollywood movies are making us violent or something like that. I personally cringe against that.
Right, right, right.
I don't know, what do you think about that?
I have mixed feelings. I mean, I think that this idea of normalizing certain types of behaviors mm-hmm. is to me of concern. Like, for instance, part of the way we have empathy is that our emotions are involved. And if you reduce your emotional response to kind of bad behavior towards other humans, I do worry that it leads to higher tolerance of violent behavior.
You know, my kid's 11. I don't want her to watch an R-rated movie.
Right, right, right.
I mean, at the very least, she's not going to be able to sleep after that, and that's
right.
just going to cause all sorts of misery at home, right?
Right, right.
I mean, that at one level. But, I mean, do I think that she's more likely to be violent because she watches? I don't know. I really think it's the context. It's how you grew up and how your parents were.
Yeah, it's the whole, yeah, I agree. Like, movies alone probably are, you know, will in isolation probably not do it, but probably the culture and the environment in the home that leads to, kind of, for instance, like a child excessively doing it probably is indicative of kind of other, you know, failings that are going on. Meaning like let's say the kid's playing, you know, kind of video games 5 hours a day in first person shooters. It could be that perhaps he's not as well connected in socially and emotionally to his family in a larger.
Oh, that's an interesting idea.
You know what I mean? So that
it's a biomarker for other situations.
That's
yeah.
right. That's right. So for instance, if you're playing 5 hours, yes, you're playing, you know, first person shooters, and yes, that may reduce your empathy towards violent behavior, but that also may be indicative that,
you're not communicating with your parents, talking about right and wrong, necessarily.
You're not having a good emotional connection to
exactly.
your parents and feeling safe and well-loved,
right.
and perhaps you have reduced, you know, kind of friendship structure. So again, it may be a biomarker, as you said, that's
yeah,
a really well-described.